study the built environment as an autonomous issue, not something that we created, but as something that we can contribute to. What the architects are talking about is the role of the architect, which is not relevant at all.
Personally, I'm not so interested in the question of what is the role of the architect. Actually, maybe it's a question which is decapacitating in general. What is your role? Because any innovation starts with the freedom to go beyond your role.
Ich lehne sippenhaft ab, oder? Insofern, der Architekt, den gibt's für mich nicht.
When you start as an architecture student, you're steeped in a culture, like a tea bag, and most of it is unconscious. It's like dropping into a foreign country. And you start using words that no one else uses, and you start developing gestures that no one else develops. And in those days, you started wearing only black and white, because that's what everyone did. Their relationships fall apart, their health falls apart, but they come up with a really great design and a beautiful presentation.
The role of the architect in every project is different. Sometimes you're the psychiatrist of a family who needs an answer to their daily or marital problems. They ask you to come and reshape the bathroom. I mean, but there's something much deeper behind it, below it.
The contradiction is that on the one hand, we claim that everything we design, everything that is built can be architecture or should be architecture. And at the same time, we want architecture to be special. Now, how can everything be special? My father had a library. He was a civil engineer. And I was interested in books, so at a certain point I found a book about the recent Dutch architecture, which was the Amsterdam School architecture. And I liked that very much, that book. And so I don't know exactly what came first. But from very early on, I decided that I wanted to go to the Netherlands and become an architect in Holland. But of course, I was also familiar with the Indonesian kampongs. Not that I was particularly consciously trying to find out how people live. Just when you take a walk through the woods, you come also in the kampongs and you see what is going on there. And what I remember is that they were also so clean and well organized. When the Japanese occupied Indonesia, the Dutch people were sort of herded in small compounds closer and closer. So the men were taken away, the women and the children in separate places. And because I was very young, I was still part of the children, so for quite a while, we lived in one room with other people. But eventually, it became more and more of a kind of concentration camp. And we were put to work in farms farther outside. At that time, I got dysentery, which was one of the major problems, of course, with the bad food that you got. So I could no longer do the work, and I had to check into the sort of makeshift hospital. And I spent the last year in the hospital. I do remember that I celebrated the fact that I was in the hospital for 1 year. To sum it up, to me it was a positive experience. I sort of, you learn to know yourself, and you learn to that you need very little to live, which I always appreciated. So it was not a traumatic experience for me. When I got better, I decided I wanted to go to Holland, whereas my parents and my sister wanted to stay in Indonesia. So I got myself a job on a transportation ship that brought back families from Indonesia to Holland. Now you have to bear in mind that housing was not discussed very much. Nobody thought about doing housing as a final project. It was only much later that students in Delft were allowed to do their final project on a housing project. But in my days, this was not considered to be architecture. But I had become intrigued by what was going on in housing. I liked the Amsterdam school and the history of it very much. I liked the Dutch cities very much. And I was appalled by the mass housing that was going on. So I tried to figure out what was going wrong. Of course, the idea that people could do their own thing was attractive to many, but they didn't think it was very realistic. I think my interest was very much in fields, in not in a single building, already from the beginning. Maybe in retrospect, I realized better than then that I was thinking about these continuities and try to understand how such complex organizations could come about as the result of bottom-up, small-scale interventions by people themselves. And I was convinced that it was right, that there was no reason not to introduce the users into the process. But then I had to explain to myself and to other people why it was important to do that. Was it important for the people? Yes. But not only, it was also important for architecture, and it was important for built environment. Having an idea in architecture is customary. Everybody must have a good idea and then follow the idea, and it must be original. That was not the kind of idea I had.
Deze scheiding is in wezen een politiek probleem. Want het fundamentele politieke probleem is dat we moeten uitmaken waar de rechten van het individu liggen en waar de verplichtingen van de gemeenschap liggen. Welke verantwoording heeft het individu en welke verantwoording draagt de gemeenschap?
The book, I thought when I have written the book, everybody will understand it and I can go back to architecture and design things. So life is too short.
Zo goed als in het verkeer de gemeenschap wegen bouwt, waardoor het individu zich met zijn eigen gekozen vervoersmiddel kan bewegen, zo zou je ook in de woningbouw twee sferen kunnen onderscheiden. De gemeenschap bouwt dan geen wegen, maar bouwt een drager. En daarin kan het individu zich met behulp van zijn immerpakketten zelf een woning vormen. En in die twee sferen zouden we moeten gaan produceren. Aan de ene kant moet de gemeenschap iets doen, aan de andere kant kan daardoor het individu iets doen. En daarom willen we dragers en inbouwpakketten gaan maken.
Drager en inbouw, hè? Structure and infill. That's of course an exemplification of a much deeper theory about the end of signature architecture. And the claim that a new school should arise, a new appreciation of what the architect should do and what the people should do.
I decided in the book not to give pictures of my own designs or suggestions for the simple reason that it would be easy to dismiss it. To say, well, that's Habrakan's architecture. We don't have nothing to do with that. I wanted people to begin to think about their own way of working.
He is a very strong believer in the truth about architecture. And since the truth can do, in his view, his truth can do without images, he would feel it as a corruption to rely on imagery all the time.
Everybody said, well, show me what it looks like, well, there's no pictures in it, and so on. And I said, okay, if you don't want to read the book, I'll give you pictures. Mm-hmm. So basically the same argument was given here in diagrams, and people loved it.
One of the strong things in the book John wrote about the supports and the people, that he didn't make a design of a support in it. So that's an open question. I'm defining it on a more or less philosophical, theoretical way. So we know what the support is, but everyone has to fill it in with his own ideas.
The book was first published in Holland in 62, and it was published in English in 72. And then I got, not many, but I got letters from people in different places who reacted. And I specifically remember that I got a letter from somebody who said this was the real Marxist approach to things and that was the way to go. And maybe 1 or 2 weeks later I got a letter from somebody who said, finally we have a real capitalist approach to housing. And I found it interesting because it proved, I think, in my mind that my proposal was something universal. And that it was interesting that people actually project their own world view into it.
10 architectenbureaus en de Bond van Nederlandse Architecten richtte 5 jaar geleden de Stichting Architecten Research, de SAR, op om de gedachten van professor Habraken over woning- en stedenbouw nader uit te werken. De stichting voert zelf geen bouwprojecten uit, maar verricht alleen onderzoek, al dan niet in opdracht.
People have been hoping of SAR that we were solving problems or going to solve problems. But in fact we were not solving problems, although in the initial phase, maybe we even had that pretension that we are solving problems. But what we were in fact doing was to clarify problems.
Bijzonder bij het experiment is dat de overheid de drager heeft getoetst, dat we zeggen de hoofdstructuur, met daarbinnen een fictief vastgestelde verkaveling, dus de vaststelling van de woninggroottes, en daarbinnen weer fictieve plattegronden. En dat ze op die basis dus het licht op groen gegeven hebben en ook de subsidie hebben vastgesteld. En die subsidie is later niet meer opnieuw in de discussie gekomen toen de bewoners zelf met hun plattegronden aankwamen. En dat had natuurlijk best gekund, want een boel van die plattegronden die wijken in wezen flink af van de gebruikelijke plattegronden. Wijken af van normen die door de overheid worden gehanteerd.
Ik was in Rotterdam en toen las ik een advertentie in een blad. En daar werden deze experimentele wijkwoningen werden daar aangeboden. En toen zeg ik tegen mevrouw, kijk, experimenteel, dat is nou juist wat voor ons.
Ik vond ook zo leuk was dat wij ook regelmatig kwamen om...
Nou, dat is het hem juist.
Om af te
Want dat experimentele betekende, het, zoals mevrouw al zegt, dat betekende dat wij dus zelf onze woning in kunnen... de indeling van onze woning in handen hadden. Hoe we hem ingericht wilden hebben.
Ik moet hem eigenlijk goed in de zon zetten. En het principe van kleinere toegangshoven en grotere tuinenhoven zie je met verschillende indelingsmogelijkheid. Dus dit was eigenlijk een soort principe plattegrond. En ik wilde laten zien dat je dus twee principieel verschillende oplossingen kan maken. Dus die tuinenhof is dit, met een groot middengebied, openbaar of half openbaar. En die andere hof die is veel meer ingedeeld in tuinen, met kleine tuintjes in de hoeken en dan grotere tuinen en het hele lange tuinen hebben. En daar moesten we ook allemaal aan wennen, dat je dus grote woningen hebt met kleine tuinen, kleine woningen met grote tuinen, grote woningen met grote tuinen en kleine woningen met kleine tuinen en zo boven ook. Dus dat er een klein woning met een grote terras kwam ook voor. En de theorie achter het verhaal is natuurlijk dat iedereen is verschillend. Er zijn mensen die alleenstaande maar die fantastische dakterras weten te maken. En anderen die hebben er helemaal geen hobby aan.
We zijn er ook heel blij mee. Daarom komen we hier ook niet weg.
Ja, nou, ik kan me voorstellen.
Jongens, de bomen zijn zo hoog omdat we hier zo lang wonen.
Ja.
Ik hield de spreekuren. 123, ja. Een half jaar lang. Wow. Twee middagen in de week. Wow. Soms in de avond. Ja, dat moet één keer doen, hè. Ja. Mijn vader was een huisarts. Dus ik kende spreekuur. Er mocht niemand anders bij. Dus de mensen praten over privacy. Over eigen dingen. Sommige koppels over seksualiteit. Of hoe we met de kinderen omgaan en zo. Dat waren de onderwerpen die ik opstel. Wat zijn je hobby's?
En nou is eigenlijk de vraag van eerste instantie, wat doen we hier en wat doen we daar?
Hier was de keuken. Dit was voor keuken bedoeld, voor woonkeuken.
Ja?
Met berging.
Ja, met de berging.
De berging die hoort dus
de keuken. Bij de keuken.
Ja? En je denkt ook te eten in die keuken?
Ja.
Zo groot is die dus dan?
Ja.
En we moeten natuurlijk binnenkomen in het huis.
Ja.
En het mag nou eenmaal niet rechtstreeks. Dus we zullen
een halletje
van maken. Ja. Dan,
Participation is really a paternalistic term because it assumes, it implies that the professionals make the world and that they are willing to let the people in, let them participate. The reality is the other way around. There is a built environment which has its own laws and a very complex entity that always has been around for thousands of years. And the question is, to what extent can the architect participate to make it better? So we talk about the intervention and the participation of the architect in the built environment and not the participation of the people in the work of the architect.
There was another project where the people take an initiative. A group of 50 users want to build a neighborhood together with open building and sustainability. And so the first interest to have their own house realized. So I had to convince them that we should speak first about what is for them in common, what they want to share together to create a neighborhood. For instance, if they want to see each other often or not. And the two extremes are, you build a high-rise building for 50 dwellings and you see your neighbors only in the staircase by accident. Or you have all the front doors together around the courtyard and you see each other, and there is a problem of social control, of course. So do you really want that or not?
Je krijgt hier eigenlijk weer die interessante tegenstelling dat door het kiezen van een uitgangspunt en een thema stedenbouwkundig en door dat te herhalen eigenlijk daardoor juist variatie mogelijk wordt. En in dat opzicht heeft Van der Werf geloof ik iets gedaan wat in de tegenwoordige interpretatie van woningbouw en stedenbouw juist helemaal niet gezocht wordt. Namelijk dat hij duidelijk een thema kiest, niet bang is om dat voor te zetten, om duidelijke uitspraken te doen. En dat dat niet leidt tot...